of course, most of us, alhamdulillah, is familiar with the story. But today, I'm not going to concentrate with you on the actual story. I'm going to concentrate of the lessons learned from the story. But let me give you a summary of it. Then we can go through all these gems that we can, inshallah, share together. And again, the story goes as Musa alayhi salam one day was given a lecture, and somebody asked him, is there anyone that is more knowledgeable than you are? He says, no one is more knowledgeable than you are. But he actually was not very doing it in the proper, in a way that he's arrogant or so on. He didn't think anybody else was actually more knowledgeable than he was. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to teach us a lesson through Prophet Musa alayhi salam when he sent Al-Khadr. And obviously he told him, you will find him in the place where we can go with your student, noon and so on. And you'll find out where he is when you, there's a mark. When you lose the fish, you'll find him there. Just to make a long story short, he actually was looking forward to learn from him, looking forward to who it is, and obviously he learned something. So we'll find out the stories after we finish this. We're going to go through whatever it is that we are going to listen, and there's plenty of beautiful lessons and wisdom behind this story. So let's go into the story itself, inshallah, where Khidr alayhi salam, he actually told him, "Don't, is it enough for you to have the Torah in your hand?" But he was so eager to learn. He says, no, I need to follow you. He says, you will not be able to follow me. And he put conditions on himself. And even when Prophet Muhammad says, I wish that Musa alayhi salam did not put these conditions, I wanted to learn more of these miracles of Khidr alayhi salam. I'm not going to go to debate whether he was a prophet, whether it's not important at this point. Okay, so we're going to learn also from that story that we're not going to dig into something that's called ilmun la yanfa'u wa jahlun la yadur, knowledge that will not benefit us and ignorance that will not harm us. So when he went with Al-Khidr alayhi salam, he saw a ship. And the ship, they did him a favor. So they took him from one side to the other and did not charge him. So this was, just keep that in mind. I'm not going to go into the details yet. But they didn't take anything else. But Al-Khidr alayhi salam, he took a piece of wood from the ship. Musa alayhi salam did not understand it. How could that be? These people were so nice to us. They took us and without charging us anything. How could you do that? So he told him, we agreed that you're not going to ask. Okay. Then after this, he went to another a story where he had to kill a child. And how could you kill a child? What's going on? This person he's not even reached puberty, and so on and so forth. And the third one, where he actually went to a village, they were hungry, they were tired, and these people were so stingy and miser. There are no hospitality whatsoever. And they did not even host on them. He found a wall. He actually rebuilt it. So this is just a summary of it. But the most important part, as I said, I'm going to concentrate on is the lessons learned from that story. So he said, if you wish, you could have taken money from these people. So how do you actually ruin a ship that helped us and then charge us money? And how do you kill a child that was an innocent that committed no sin? And how do you build a wall with people that did not even feed us or being hospitable with us? So he says, now you put that condition upon yourself. First, the lahja was different. The way you talked was different. So this hadha faraqu bayni wa bayni. Khalas, that's the condition. You put this on yourself. I didn't. So now let me tell you what it's all about. So now let's find out what is the lessons learned from this and the wisdom behind it and the gems that we're going to talk about, inshallah. So number one on the list is the Qissat Musa ma'a al-Khidr min rawa'i al-Qisas. It is amazing story. In the Quran, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, نحن نقص عليك أحسن القصص. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was telling Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we tell you the best of stories. He was trying to give Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam some kind of condolences indirectly to tell him, you know what, if these people don't believe in you and all of that. And he's one of the things, وَمَا ذُكْرَ بِالْقُرْآنِ. This is something else that to be added. Number two, because quite a few lessons actually, there are over 40. So I'm not going to dwell too much. Unless it's worth it, then I will stick. If not, then we'll just talk about it briefly and move on, inshallah. So number two, it says, عَلَى الْعَالِمِ أَنْ يُفَضْلِ النَّزَاعَ بَيْنَ الْمُخْتَلِفِينَ. So he says now, the scholarly, the difference between the scholar and the student, to understand the difference. And know also that the Sahaba differed. So please, it is okay to differ, but what is the lesson learned here? The lesson is, there's something called أَدَابِ الْخِلَافِ, not خِلَافِ الْأَدَبِ. Adab al-khilaf is we understand we have to discuss issues with the etiquettes and matters of us being able to discuss it in a proper manner without having to use any foul language, without having to hate each other or hate each other and so on and so forth. Without having to go to the media, don't listen to this scholar, this is the way of Dal and all of that stuff. Take him out of the millah and may Allah help us. And that's why the students of knowledge get confused. Because now these are our scholars, they're fighting each other. Where do we go? And who do we follow? So I'm telling you, please, brothers, sisters, if you're in a da'wah scene, stay away from this. Don't name any names. As a matter of fact, one of my teachers says, as soon as any question comes to you with the name of a scholar, don't answer it. And that's the rule. If anybody tells you, this scholar said so-and-so, I stop. I do not answer the question. Because first of all, I have not heard that scholar say that. Nor that I know what that scholar was asked the question in what circumstances, what conditions, and who was asking and why. So I refrain from answering any question that belongs to anybody else. Nor that I want to answer a question that belongs to any country. Because they have their own scholars. I don't know what's going on. So these are the things that we have to understand. So it's now the difference between the scholars is Abdullah ibn Abbas and Ubay ibn Ka'b. Was Musa alayhi salam from Bani Israel or am ghayrihi? Didn't matter. It wasn't important. Number three says, "Wajib al-khatib an ya'ad al-nas al-mu'ib al-baliq al-mu'athira." Allah Ta'ala ila amal, which means what? When Al-Khidr alayhi salam and Musa alayhi salam were talking, when he was giving him wisdom, he was telling him something, do something. So if I'm not going to tell you what to do after I tell you, it's just waste of time. And this is one thing our teachers always tell us. Listen, there's your track of here's your storyline. Your beginning, the three tells. Tell them what you're going to tell them. Tell them and tell them what you told them. And you have 3 points to concentrate on. And repeat the 3 points 3 times in the beginning, in the middle, and the end. And the etiquettes and matters of which you do so. And the way you project. And how you actually pick 3 points. And so it's called train the trainer. So this person of Allah has been through the training. And this is how you're supposed to do it. So by the time I tell you something, I have to tell you, speak in your language. Relate something to you. And then after I teach you, then you do what? Here's your homework. So you have to come up with beneficial. So Ibn Qayyim rahmatullah alayhi says you have to do 3 things. Alif, thumma arif, thumma kallif. Alif al-qulub, reconcile the hearts. Arif, then educate, raise awareness. Then obligate after that. And that's number 3 on the list. Number 4 is yabdu anna rajul alladhi lahaqa bi Musa wa sa'alahu qad a'jabatuhu bi khutbatihi wa kalami. Fadhanna ahl al-ilm annahu ahl al-nas. He says now a'lam ahl al-ard. So when Musa alayhi salam talked to this person, he was asking, he was speaking eloquently, so he thought he was the most knowledgeable. And that's why he was asking, are you the most knowledgeable? And Musa alayhi salam, as I mentioned earlier, he did not take that personal. Says, yes, I'm a prophet and messenger among the ulil azm. Who else is here? So he did not know that. Number 5 on the list, he says, laysa bil hadith ma yadulla anna Musa alayhi salam kana mutakabbiran. Meaning, in this hadith that we just talked about briefly, it was not an indication that Musa alayhi salam was among the arrogant ones. And I just told you, he's among the 5. What are the 5? It's Ibrahim alayhi salam, Nuh alayhi salam, Musa alayhi salam, Isa alayhi salam, and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. From the 5, Allah chosen the 2. The 2 which is Ibrahim alayhi salam, Khalilan, and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. From the 2, Allah chosen 1. And that one was obviously Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And that's the case. We have to keep perspective and respect for our prophets and messengers accordingly, inshallah. Number 6. وَمَا يُدْلِلْ عَلَى عَدَمْ كِبْرُ مُوسَىٰ أَنَّهُ كَانَ مِنَ الْمُبَادَرِ لِلْقَاءِ عَبْدِ الصَّالِحِ. Now the proof that he was not arrogant, and he was actually conscious. He was very much in tuned and focused to meet Khidr alayhi salam, to learn from him. Even though it was difficult, even though it was far, it didn't matter. But he was so adamant about acquiring knowledge and learning from somebody else, even though he's a prophet and messenger himself. And it's very difficult, by the way. You understand it's difficult for you when you're the teacher to learn from others. Because you're the one in the power position. You're the one who people listen to you. Can you imagine now? You're not in the power position. You're now listening mode, not telling mode. You're now in the learning mode, not teaching mode. Very difficult for him, but he was very adamant in order for him to find Al-Khidr alayhi salam and learn from him. And that's a clear proof that he was not arrogant whatsoever. Number 7 is ينبغي لمن سأل مثل هذا السؤال أي الناس أعلم أن يقول الله أعلم. Now, number 7 on the list, he says, if somebody asks you a question, my brothers and sisters, if you don't know the answer, please, have mercy on yourself and don't sign on behalf of Allah subhanahu wa jalla in vain. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, من كذب علي متعمدا فليتبوأ مقعده من النار. If you lie upon me intentionally, meaning what? If you say something that I didn't say, that he said, or you said he didn't say it and he said it, go ahead, choose your place in the hellfire. And that's just the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wa sallam. Can you imagine doing that to Allah subhanahu wa jalla fi ala? So please make sure that you don't, you say Allahu a'lam. Qala la adri 'allamahu Allah. You say I don't know, Allah will teach you. I was just talking today about Imam Malik rahmatullah alayhi. He says, you know what, la adri in so many things. You understand? He says, even Imam Malik rahmatullah alayhi said that. So please understand, when you're doing the talib al-ilm, and by the way, you're going to go through three phases when you're acquiring knowledge. First one is arrogance. Second one is humbleness. And the third one is ignorance. Because when you learn something, oh, I learned something. I listened to the sheikh. I went to this class. I read this book and whatever it is. I watched that lecture. I know something. I don't, wallahi, we don't. Learning, we're just crawling on the knowledge, the path of knowledge. So you feel that you're, oh, I now know something, that you feel like you're arrogant. Number two, when you get asked a question, you don't even know what the question means, let alone answer the question. You become humble. You go in the masjid with S on the chest, Sheikh, yes? And you get asked a question, then you go back and you feel a position. You don't know what it is. Yeah, so you humble yourself down. And then when the more you know that you don't know, and that's the ignorance, ignorant part. Number eight on this list is فضل الرحلة في طلب العلم فقد رحل إليه الأنبياء والمرسلون. Now, you know what? We did not have this www.org and .net and .com. We had to travel to learn from the scholars. You guys are lucky, mashallah, tabarakallah. This young generation, you're only a click away from listening to this and listening to that. Alhamdulillah, Allah made it easy for you. Take advantage of it. We had to travel. We had to leave. I remember, wallahi, when I used to work and do this on the side, my mother, and this is, my mother actually told me, you know, give time to your family. You know, because I wasn't really. I was preparing the khutbas and halaqas on planes, in a hotel room, and whatever it is. I didn't have time. So I said, خلوا بيني وبين ربي. Wallahi, I remember that. So it is a blessing, my brothers and sisters, when you do and you're dedicated to acquire knowledge. When you travel, you learn something about yourself. You know, this person of Allah traveled a lot by the blessing. And you learn something about yourself. You learn that you discover things. So it says, طلب العلم, you know, acquiring knowledge, and you're traveling. Is even prophets and messengers did this. Who are we not to? We have to invest in that, inshallah. Number nine on the list is istihbab ta'allum al-alim min man huwa a'lam minhu, anna al-ilm bahr la sahil lahu. He says it is befitting even for those who learn it, acquiring knowledge from those who are actually more knowledgeable than they are. Look, now, I'll be honest with you. Every time I go somewhere in a conference or whatever, I think that I was doing an amazing job with my community, only to be humbled and belittled with the other mashaykh and dua wallahi. You're doing that and you're doing this, and I learn from them and I bring it back, and that's what it's all about. And that's one of the reasons I actually like going to conferences, to learn from other mashaykh wallahi, to go and listen to their lectures. And that's one thing, because we talk a lot, and if we listen from somebody else, it means a lot to us. We say it, it doesn't impact us as much. But when we actually hear it from somebody else, we hear it. Even Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, he says, wallahi, I memorized the Quran, but when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died, what happened? When Abu Bakr said, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ رُسُلٌ أَفَإِنْ مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلَ انْقَلَبْتُمْ عَلَى عَقِبِكُمْ وَمَنْ يَنْقَلِبْ عَلَى عَقِبِهِ لَيْسَ لَهُ مِنَ اللَّهِ شَيْءٌ. As if I heard the ayah for the first time, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that, when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died, so what everybody else says, if you say this, Abu Bakr, you say it, I will take your head off. So he said the ayah, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a messenger. Messengers, prophets before him, that happened. It's nothing new. Says that if he died and were killed, will you turn around and walk away from Allah? If you do so, you will not harm Allah any. So he says, as if I heard the ayah for the first time. So it is okay for a learned person. I'm seeking knowledge. To acquire knowledge from others. I'm still learning, wallahi, up till this now. When the people ask this person of Allah a question, if I don't know it, I will talk to my mashayikh. And it's not a shame, my brother and sister, to ask. We're learned from that cradle to the grave, inshallah. That's it. Acquiring knowledge is something that is obligatory upon us, inshallah. Number 10 on this one, because it says this knowledge is an ocean and there's no shores. There is no limit on this one. Number 10 on this one is مشروعية خدمة أهل الفضل والعلم فقد خدم يوسع بن موسى في رحلة طلب العلم. So it is okay for a person that is learning from a sheikh or a da'iya to serve them. It is okay. You get the reward for them, inshallah. And that is narrated in so many other ways. Number 11 says, مَشْرُعِيَّةِ حِمْلِ الزَّادِ وَالطَّعَامِ فِي السَّفَرِ. It is okay also to have your zad. A zad, what is that? فَتَزَوَّدُوا فَإِنَّ خَيْرَ الزَّادِ التَّقْوَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاتَّقُونِي يَا أُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. The zad ما يحتاجه المسافر للحياة. The zad is what the traveler needs in order for you to sustain your life. So that is also permissible in this story. ان نمبر 12 از معجزه موسى عليه السلام في هذه الرحله والحوت المشوي. So we also understand that how do you have a barbecued fish? A barbecued fish, you know what, leaves you and go ahead, go back in the water. Speaking of that, Imam Kishk, rahmatullah alayhi, may Allah have mercy upon him, is one of the pillars of the ummah. That he was imprisoned, he was harmed, and he didn't, لا يخاف الله من الكلام, blind, but he was a vision, not the heart. No, no, he saw the truth, subhanAllah. He was saying in a joke that, you know what, one man he was going against the sunnah, because when you want to break your fast early. So this man had a barbecued fish waiting for him. And then when he broke his fast, he said, you know what, no, I'm strong, I can take it. So I wanted to pray first. The window was open, however, unfortunately. So a cat came in through the window and, barbecued fish, yummy. Mm-mm-mm. So the cat comes in towards the fish, and this man has already said Allahu Akbar, he's in the prayer, he can't come out. So what does he do? Now he says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Bisinta akhuya. He says, you're out. So we don't go extreme one way or the other, inshallah. So one of the things that, you know, even if the fish was cooked and ready to be eaten, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts back life in it and actually takes to that, goes back to the water, and that was a sign where he was going to meet Al-Khidr alayhi salam. Number 13, في إحياء الله للحوت المملح, says دليل على بعث مشاهد البحث. Says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also tells you that that is also a sign of resurrection. So he's telling that, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given that even the prophets and messengers a lesson in aqidah and belief to increase it. أَوَلَمْ تُؤْمِنْ لِكَيْ يَطْمَئِنَّ قَلْبِي. It is not. It is things that happen to you in your life that will increase your iman. لَيْسَ بَعْدَ الْعَيْنِ أَيْنِ. You know what that means? It says after you see things, it is nothing more than that, and it doesn't increase anything because I've seen it. I've been there. Yeah, رَأْيَ الْعَيْنِ. It says number 14 on that one is مَشْرُوعِيَةُ إِخْبَارِ الرَّجُلِ عِنْدَ تَعَبِهِ وَرَهَقِهِ. It is okay to say when you're tired, you're tired. Yes. Even Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, this woman here, you know what, she's holding up on the rope to be able to do more qiyam. Says, you know what, Allah did not ask for this. Let her down. Let that rope down. The man that take a nadr, he made a vow that he will walk. He will walk to perform Hajj and Umrah. He says, put this man on his horse. Allah does not want this difficulty. So brothers and sisters, يريد الله بكم العسر لا يريد بكم اليسر لا يريد بكم العسر. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to make it easy for you, not difficult for you. So please. Don't do that, and that's the path and the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Number 14, it says, جواز النسيان في حق الأنبياء. You know what? It is permissible for prophets and messengers to forget. They're human beings, يعني. Even Prophet Muhammad says, unsiya, he was made to forget for the mashru'iyyat that's through the sahu, for us to follow if we forget in the prayer, because he's a mushari'. I understand I'm not going to go as easy. Shari'a, mushari'a, or musharih. Okay, it's a long story. So linguistically, it is permissible. But I'm not going to go again to aqidah issues here. Yeah, so it is permissible to do so. And number 16 on the list is يظهر صبر المعلم على تلميذه ما وقف موسى مع تلميذه حين أخبره أنه نسي. It is permissible also to, when you have a student to do so, you have to have patience with them. The relationship between the student and the teacher is amazing. And he had patience with him when he says, I forgot. He didn't cook like that. Chastise him. And he didn't do anything else. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu anhu, served him 10 years. Didn't tell me why you did this, why you didn't do this, nothing. And that's the relationship, my brothers and sisters, with two souls. Number 17 is قبول العذر الناسي من شيم الصالحين. Listen, brothers and sisters, كن خير آخر. Be the best, take the high road, my brothers and sisters. If somebody forgets, if somebody makes a mistake, don't chastise them again. And this is the etiquettes and manners of the righteous. So be among the righteous, forgive and forget. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ أَن يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. I was talking to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. When the story of Mistah was one of his own family members. He helped him financially. And he said what he said in the Haqq of Aisha, in the Hadith of Ifk, Hadith of Ifk in Surah An-Nur. Again, not too many things I'm throwing at you, but it was sticking here. You know. But he did not say, he said, I know, I want Allah to forgive me. He gave him back the money and more. Yes? So please, forgive and forget. And that's righteous of it, inshallah. Number 18 on the list, وَمِنْ أَدَبْ طَالِبِ الْعِلْمِ أَنْ يُخْبِرِ الْمُعَلِّمِ بِصَبْرِهِ عَلِيهِ. So he says it is good also to recognize that in your teacher and appreciate it. That you know what? Not only from one to another. As a matter of fact, Musa alayhi salam told that to Al-Khidr alayhi salam. He says, I appreciate that I'm going to be difficult upon you, and be patient with me, and have chances, another chance, a third chance. And you say, appreciate that, inshallah. Number 19, it says, مُعَلِّم مُوسَى هُوَ الْخِضْرِ كَمَا أَخْبِرَ بِذَلِكَ الْحَدِيثِ قَدْ سُمِّيَ الْخَضْرَ خَضْرًا لَأَنَّهُ جَلَسَ عَلَى فَرْوَى بَيْضَاءَ فَهْتَزَّتْ تَحْتَهِ خَضْرًا. So, okay, so إِنَّمَا سُمِّيَ الْخِضْرُ أَنَّهُ جَلَسَ عَلَى. This is in the hadith, inshallah. Al-Khadr is green. Okay, so he was sitting on a white mat, it turned into green. And some of them, or others when we used to walk, it turned into green. Again, this is something that's Sahih Bukhari. Number 20 is الظاهر أن تلك البلاد التي كان يجلس فيها الخضر كانت مطبقة بالكفر. So لذلك استغرب أن يكون أهل بلاد من رياض الإسلام. So he says, you know what? Now we know that these people did not return the salam. So now it's apparent that these people that they went to were not actually a Muslim country. And among the signs of times, brothers and sisters, that you only say salam to those who know. So from now on, anyone you see, you say salamu alaykum. 10 حسنات. Salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. 20. Salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh. 30 hasanat. Why don't we do this, my brothers and sisters? When you go into a masjid, you have to only say, I know this brother. I say salam. I don't know this brother. I don't know say salam. This man is rich. Salam alaikum. This man is poor. This man, I want to marry his daughter. Salam alaikum. This man has a job. Salam alaikum. Wallahi, it's not going to be that. So you can expand, inshallah. Afshu salam abaynakum. Have I not told you what it was going to bring you salam back? Afshu salam. Say salam in abundance. Open. Some of the sahaba used to go and walk in, and they separate with one tree, come back, say salam alaikum, ya akhi. So please come back, inshallah, to that. Number 21, الخضر بشر لا يعلم الغيب لأنه طلب من موسى أن يعرفه بنفسه. So if you think that الخضر عليه السلام knows now the غيب and the unseen and all of that stuff, that's not true. He was only told by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do certain things. That's it, limited. So we don't go extravagant or extreme one way or the other in understanding what the khidr's nature also. Because if he knew the truth about the future, he would not have asked Musa alayhi salam, what's your name? Because if he knew that, he would not have asked him. And anybody claims to know the ghaib or how to help others, listen. Or how to heal and all of that stuff, listen. Can you help us in the COVID-19, man? You know, the hospitals are full. Why don't you go ahead and heal the people, okay? These people cannot even help themselves. So please, don't be fooled and keep that in mind, inshallah. طيب. It says number 22 is العلم الذي يملكه الخضر يختلف عن علم عن كل علم. So it's called أتاه الله. It's called علم لدني. The knowledge of الخضر عليه السلام was different than any other علم of others because it's called علم لدني. لدنا علم. علم لدني, that means straight from Allah. However, there are certain sects. May Allah guide us all and forgive us all. They say our imams have لدني علم. You know, even prophets and messengers stopped at the shores of our people. يا إلهي, what? You know, I don't know what, may Allah forgive us. That's Allah. I'm not going to go play politics here, but you can understand that. So this ilm is different. It's called ladunni ilm. Ladunni ilm. It comes from Allah subhanahu wa jalla kiyula. Number 23 on the list is laysa kullu ma yadhunnu al-insanu annahu qadir ala fi'lihi yaf'aluhu. Is even Musa alayhi salam akhbara al-khidr annahu qadir ala tahammul al-ilm. And he didn't. Walakin lahu lam yasbir. So not everything you think you can do, you can do. And it's okay. It is okay to put a high bar for yourself. But my advice to you, my brothers and sisters, go gradually. Otherwise, tusab bi something called futur. Tusab bil futur. You will be plagued with something called what? I give up. I can't do it. It's not sustainable. So gradual learning. Marketing. Gradual growth. So don't go expand so fast and so far. And don't bite more than you can chew. So learn. Have the hunger. Have the commitment. Have the zeal. But please also understand that things that you can do and things you can do. And he actually told him, I cannot. I'm not patient. Even though I wanted to acquire this knowledge. But I will not, we're not able to do it. Number 24, يستحب لمن هم بشيء أن يقول إن شاء الله. So if you want to do something, my brothers and sisters, you have to say inshallah. Even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told that to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Surah Al-Kahf, same surah. So if you say something inshallah, it's in mashi'atillah. So we can't guarantee that we wake up in the morning. We can't guarantee anything. So we have to say inshallah, my brothers and sisters. But when I lived in Saudi, you know, I had one of the places I visited, one of the chefs was German. When one of his chefs said, inshallah, he says, no, inshallah. You know why? Because we say inshallah as a habit, as a cultural. So let's say inshallah and mean it, not just, you know, get off my back. Okay, what are you going to do? Oh, yeah, inshallah. Don't do that. Mean it, inshallah. Very good. So 25, من الأوصاف العظيمة لعلم الله تعالى ما قاله الخضر لموسى عندما رأى الطائر يأخذ من الماء. It's amazing. You know what? When Musa alayhi salam saw that the bird dip his beak into the in the ocean and took that, this is, you know, your ilm and my ilm, It means absolutely nothing like that. You see that bird took out of the ocean, which means what? The ilm of Musa alayhi salam, the ilm of al-Khidr alayhi salam is absolutely nothing. Yeah, it's like a bird taking a drop of water from the ocean. You understand now the ilm? Brother, so if you ever start thinking that you have ilm, you've started to become an ignorant. So this ilm is no boundaries. No boundaries. That's why Ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullah says, Ya Mufahim Sulaiman Fahimni, Ya Muallim Dawood Allimni. Oh, the one that made Sulaiman understand, let me understand. Oh, the one that let Dawood alayhi salam learn, teach me. SubhanAllah, that's Ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullah alayhi. So again, the Shafi'i rahmatullah says, شربنا زمزم للعلم فتعلمناه ولو شربناها للتقوى لكان أفضل. الله أكبر يا شيخ. Ibn الشافعي رحمة الله عليه وهو من هو. And he is who is. He says we drank Zamzam for knowledge. That's the intention. We learned it. Alhamdulillah. I wish I drank Zamzam with taqwa. Look at his humbleness. SubhanAllah. عجيب والله. طيب. If that's case, he says number 26 now. ينبغي لمن رأى المنكر أن ينكره كما أنكر موسى أفعال الخضر عليه السلام. If you see something wrong, you can actually say it's wrong. But remember, I'm going to tell you three things. The hadith says, من رأى منكم منكراً فليغيره بيده ومن لم يستطع بلسانه ومن استطع بقلبي وهذا أضعف الإيمان. Let me explain the hadith, please, before you go nuts on me, okay? So don't take matters in your own hand, bottom line, okay? So fear said, if you see something wrong, you can change it. What's level number one? With your hand. Who does that? Us? No. It's the people of authority, like the government, the police, the army, anybody like that, that has the authority to discipline people. Not everybody take matters on hand. If you're not, مَنْ لَمْ يَسْتَطِعْ فَبِلِسَانِي. Who's that? The scholars. The scholars will tell the umara, اتَّقِ اللَّهِ. Be conscious of Allah. Establish the hukm of Allah, and so on and so on. Now, number three, if you're not in power, you're not a scholar, at least abhor it, deny it in your heart. And that's the least amount, but at least you have the right to deny it in your heart. So you have to enjoin good and forbid evil. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that we are the best of nations, because we do so. Number 27, جواز نقض العهد عند رؤية المنكر. فقد شرط الخضر على موسى وتعهد الله لا يحتج شيء يراه ولكن موسى نقضه عند رؤية المنكر. Okay, so that means it is permissible for you to break your covenant, an oath and a pledge that you've taken when you see something wrong. Look, I made an oath with you, but does that mean that if I see something wrong because I made the oath and I'm going to be quiet? No, I'm not going to be quiet. I'm still going to be able to say enjoining good and for people. What is say is haram is haram, and what is halal is haram. Halal is halal. You know what I mean? You know, I just broke the fast again. I don't know. It's a little bit, Allahu musta'an. طيب. Number 28, الحكم بالظاهر حتى يتبين خلافه. What does that mean? I am commanded to take what's apparent. I don't go into anybody's mindset. I don't go to anybody's intention. I don't go to anybody's heart. I don't know what your intention with your sincerity. I don't know. Don't boast about yourself. Allah knows what's in your heart. Allah knows who has taqwa. Not this person of Allah. Allah knows that. So we can take what is apparent, and we are not allowed to go internally because we don't have that power. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what's in the heart. Number 29. يزيد في الجرم إساءة المرء لمن أحسن إليه. It is multiply bad. It is many folds bad if you actually, or worse, or the worst is you're being good to those who are good to you, to being bad to those who are good to you. You know, it's called إحسان. إحسان is what? ليس الإحسان أن تحسن من أحسن إليه ولكن الإحسان أن تحسن من أساء إليه. You understand what إحسان is? Excelling. Not being good to those who are good to you, that's normal. But you're being good to those who are bad to you, that's excelling. And that's what he says. If you're a criminal, if you're going to be good to those who are bad to you, I'm sorry, you're going to be bad to those who are good to you. I'm also dyslexic, just in case you're wondering. Okay, move on. Number 30 on the list is what? جواز ارتكاب أخف الضررين لتفويت أشدهما. Okay, so it is permissible for you to do a lesser of both evil. How? Al-Khidr alayhi salam, he took one piece of wood, which is bad. Why? To save the ship. So it is permissible for you to use the lesser of both evils on anything that you can. But remember, you have to understand what this means before you use it, inshallah. Now, وَيَنْدَرِجْ تَحْتَ هَذَا فَسَاد بَعْضِ الشَّيْءِ لِإِصْلَاحْ مُعْظَمْهِ. For example, if you have a cancer, for example, the doctor will say, let me amputate the fingers to save the hand or to save the arm. Of course, that's what this means, yes? So please keep that in mind. Number 31 is جواز ركوب البحر كما فعل موسى والخضر عليه السلام. It is permissible to use the boat and ride the wave. Ride the wave. You going to California now, or where are you going? Yes, cruises. You know, halal cruises. Yeah, you understand? Allah musta'an. Especially you guys in Malaysia have, mashallah. And one brother from Indonesia, I met in Malaysia, I think it was. He has those halal cruises. May Allah bless him. Mashallah, tabarakallah. Number 33 is al-faqir afqar min al-miskin. Okay, let me explain that. إنما الصدقات للفقراء والمساكين, which means, what is the definition? Faqir definition is you cannot make ends meet no matter how hard you do. Miskeen is destitute. Now poor is that. Now miskeen is I can make ends meet, but it's very difficult for me to do so. So you can also distinguish between the two according to the story. Number 34, الأصل في وظيفة الملوك الحفاظ على الرعية وملكاتهم ليس صدقاتهم. Look, the king and the queen or the minister or the prime minister or the president is supposed to protect people, not to take things away from them. You know why? Because right now, unfortunately, some countries, the army is killing their own people, not their enemies. Again, I'm trying to stay away from politics, but I'm sure you can read between the lines. The difference between the prophets and messengers and those kings and queens is the prophets and messengers devoted their whole lives to serve others. But the king and queens devote the others' lives to serve them. Huge difference. So please, you have a choice between you become a Musa alayhi salam or become a Pharaoh. Wal-iyadu billahi rabbil alameen. Your choice. Number 35. Ankara Musa al-fi'l al-thani al-khadr akthar min inkaruhu al-awwal. Okay, things are, you can elevate your abhorring something or denouncing something or you're rejecting something according to its evil. Al-qadr, tuqaddar biqadriha. Meaning give it what's due right. Because if you're going to blow up on something that's minor, you're going to lose that essence. So you can do so. Alam aqul laka. The first one he said, Alam aqul innaka. So did I tell you that you, that he said, I am aqul laka innaka? He didn't say, you so and so, you will not be able to do it. But the second one he says, Alam aqul laka innaka. So the harsher one was the second one because now is you're not patient and you promised this one here, I'm going to go up a little bit. So toning up is okay, it's permissible too, accordingly. Number 36. Is لا يرضى الأب الصالح لأولاده أن يكونوا طالحين بل يزيده ذلك تعمى وإرهاقا. You know what? تعاسى أو شقاء الأبناء شقاء الأباء. Which means the difficulties that the children are going to go through is the difficulties that the parents are going to go through. So as a righteous father will not be accepting the children to be not righteous. I cannot, if you're a righteous father, you have to make sure that you're going to raise your children properly according to Quran and Sunnah, the righteous company, the righteous environment, and so on and so forth. Do not accept the fact that, you know what, oh, we live out here in the West. It's the normal here. No, we can't. Your identity is Muslim first, no matter where you are. Number 37, العبرة بصلاح الأبناء لا بعددهم كما يهتم الناس في هذا الزمان. Which means quality, not quantity. You know, some of the people I know, listen, I'm married to a Palestinian girl. You know what that means? They like children. MashaAllah, yani, Allahu Akbar. But no, what I'm saying is that good, it's good. I'm boasting about your numbers. Go ahead. I understand. But nowadays, we don't just want to concentrate on numbers. We have the numbers. But do we have the weight? We don't have the weight. Haba'a Manthura, he says, Ghudra is Sayyid. You know, the foam of the ocean? We need to have the righteous scholars, righteous doctors, righteous engineers, righteous everything. Muslim doctor, Muslim engineer, Muslim lawyer. First, if this ummah ever had a chance to turn around and walk and come back to who would lead where we belong. But at this point, we don't deserve it. So please understand that if that's the case, make sure you concentrate on the quality of the children you're raising, not just the quantity you're coming out with, inshallah. So number 38 is أحياناً يموت يكون موت الابن الضال راحة لوالديه وفرجاً لهما. Sometimes you think that you lost a child. And look, you know, been there, done that. Sheikh Abdulaziz lost three and all of that. We talk about this all the time. But this, you think it's bad, but it's actually the best thing that happened to you. As a matter of fact, the narration says that it would have been a fitna for the people that Khidr alayhi salam killed their child. Because these people were righteous and this child was going to be an evil child. And it would have been fitna for them because they would have had to change their ways in order for them to keep the child in or to please him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala abdalahum. And the reason is, وَكَانَ أَبُوهُمَ صَالِحًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even in the other story, says that the parents were righteous. So sometimes you think it's bad, my dear sister, especially it's very difficult for you to lose a child. Wallahi, I know that. But I want you to remember that they're making a noise on Judgment Day. They're not going to be entering Jannah unless you accompany them. And that's the good news, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept for those of you who have lost it and grant you something better. Ameen. Number 39 is Mashru'iyyat talab al-qut min al-nas. It is permissible to ask for your salary when you do something for them. It is not considered to be abhorred or disliked when you ask something. If you work for it, it's habs al-waqt. You've done an effort. You dedicated some time to them. You've worked hard for it. It is permissible for you to ask for your right. And here's what we get. Ya Shaykh fi sabilillah. Everything for sabilillah. Mashallah yani. Is everything for sabilillah? Well, no, everything for sabilillah, man. But you are allowed to ask, inshallah. Wallahu a'lam. Number 40. Is إطلاق البخل على أهل القرية جميعاً إذا كان أكثرهم أهل البخلاء. It is permissible, you see, because these, the whole village, not one of them hosted on Musa عليه السلام and Khidr عليه السلام. So the whole village, dude, was bad. Not one single person invited them at all. Number 41, إقامة الخضر الجدار دون أن يطلب منه أحد دل على المؤمن الراغب في الأجر وفعله وليس الأجر عليه. Again, it is permissible for you to do things for the sake of Allah, not a requiring, like Al-Khidr alayhi salam, who is seeking the reward and following the command of Allah, not seeking the people like Musa alayhi salam, who is asking him, اطلب عليه أجر, it's okay. Number 42 is صلاح الأباء ينفع الأبناء كما حصل مع الأيتام. It is beneficial for the children, their fathers. By the way, Ibn Kathir rahmatullahi alayhi said in his tafsir, وكان أبوهما صالحا, he was سابع جد. Seventh grandfather. You understand? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected the children because their seventh grandfather was righteous. Allahu Akbar. So please remember that. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, rahmatullah alayhi, he was among the Sayyid al-Tabi'in, most knowledgeable. Him and Hassan Basri. He remembered that... Okay, وَلْيَخْشَ الَّذِينَ تَرَكُمْ سُلْفِينَ ضَرَقُمْ لَعَمْ قَابُ عَلَيْهِمْ فَلِيْتَقُ اللَّهُ وَيَقُلُوا قَبْلَ سَلِيلًا. So when I read this ayah in Surah Nisa, if you fear for your lineage and progeny, you have to have two things. Swiss bank account and a private jet? Policy, insurance? No? Right. He says, فَلْيَتَّقُوا اللَّهِ. Be conscious of Allah. وَلْيَقُولُوا قَالٍ سَدِيدًا. Enjoying good forbid evil. Say righteous utterance. So remember, فَيَتَّقُوا اللَّهِ فَسْكُلْ فَيَتْ تَعْقِيبٍ. Lam here, it means طلب الأمر. Because it's فعل مضارع. Lam goes into فعل مضارع to be the طلب الأمر. If the L goes into the present tense, it's a command and a request. Wow, and alif is istimrari and jama'i, meaning ongoing and also with congregation, not on your own. Remember the son of Nuh alayhi salam, what happened to him? Kana fi ma'zalin. Yeah, the son of Nuh alayhi salam, ya bunayya kam ma'na, come ride with us. Sa'awi ila jabal, ya'asami min al-ma'. La asam, nothing, he can't help you. But what would he say? Kana fi ma'zalin. That means if your children on their own, they're not in righteous company, righteous environment, you will lose them. Even prophets and messengers have done so, so please make sure you understand that. طيب إخفاء الرجل صالح المال يدل على جواز كنز المال وتوفيره. Also hiding that, it is permissible for you to hide some treasures. I'm not asking you to hide it from your wife or your husband. I am asking you to save something for your children. It is permissible to hide it for them, inshallah, to be able to help them in the future. All right. Number 44. قصور العلم البشري عن معرفة أمور كثيرة. فقد ظن موسى أن ما فعله الخضر شرا. Now, listen, our limited mind and vision, we think a lot of things are bad. For example, this COVID-19. Wallahi, in the beginning, everybody thought, oh my God, that's it, we're toast. But wallahi, I have seen so many good things that happened to it. Asa an takra shay'an khayran lakum, maybe you abort something and it's good for you. So please understand, you got to look at the positive side. Look on the positive. That's why be optimistic, brothers and sisters. And that's why I keep repeating, people are saying Muslims are the best able to handle this calamity because of our belief, our aqeedah, inshallah. And number 45 on this one is على طالب العلم أن يتريث في الإنكار على علمه أن لا يكون مصيبة. So if you're seeking knowledge, my brothers and sisters, be patient with your teacher. Okay? Don't jump and don't compare. I heard this, I heard that. You have to show respect. And be patient. If you see something that is not right, maybe he will say something or she will say something later that will explain it. For example, when you say a certain madhab takes a certain opinion, you don't say right and wrong. You say, why did he go like this? And again, I'm not going to go there because it's not our topic for now. Number 46, تأويل ما لا يفهم ظاهري من الأقوال والأفعال والحركات. It is okay to interpret and understand in the tafsir of things that you don't understand. أن يفعل الأقوال. He didn't say anything. He didn't mean anything. But let me ask. can you please explain why? And you'll find only that Musa alayhi salam asking, but Al-Khidr alayhi salam did not leave his student in the dark area. He actually told him, here, let me tell you ta'wil. Let me now interpret and explain to you what happened. Yes? Okay, number 47. ظهر في القصة أدب جمل مع الله تعالى في عدة مواقف. Okay, first of all, the etiquettes and manners with your teacher is commanded. But can you imagine you're supposed to have more etiquettes and manners with Allah subhanahu wa jalla biula? It says even Talmid Musa, the student of Musa alayhi salam, he says, نسيت الحوت. فإني نسيت الحوت. وما أنسانيه إلا الشيطان. Even he says, he took it to himself, but the shaitan is the one. Didn't say, you know what? Oh, I forgot this. Oh, how, why, and all of that. This is in Surah Al-Kahf 63. فقد نسب النسيان إلى الشيطان, not to Ar-Rahman. You understand, guys? Okay. So it says now, you can something called Mabni Majhul, in the third person. Ma urid, even the jinn, yeah, were polite. It says, this is good or bad? If it's good, you take it to Allah. If it's not, you take it yourself. وَإِذَا مَرِضْتُ فَهُوَ يَشْفِيد. Yes? If I get sick, he is the one that provides. And that's Siyaq al-Hadith, meaning the rhythm of that, the methodology was going, it would have been Allah. But they said, no, مَرِضْتُ أَنَا. If it's good, Allah subhanahu wa jalla fi'ala. If it's bad, it's me. Okay. So, وَيَعْفُ عَنْ كَثِيرٌ. Allah subhanahu wa jalla forgives more. She's number 48. قَبُول خَبَرِ الْوَاحِدْ فِي الْعَقِيدَةِ. Now, this is an aqidah issue. Especially the Qur'aniyun. And again, it's okay to talk about it. The Qur'aniyun will not take the sunnah of the ahad. And if you tell them, okay, what is the ahad? It's khabar al-wahid. So you will not take the hadith of khabar al-wahid. But as-sahaba kulluhum udul. You understand that? The companions are all udul. This is في علوم الرجال. You'll understand when you study the fiqh al-hadith and so on. You will know that all of the sahaba were udul. That they were taken accordingly. If you look at the biography, no lying, no this, and not all of that stuff, we accept. So you say, why didn't you take it? You know, how did you get the Quran? We say through Jibreel. Well, that is ahad, ya akhi. Jibreel alayhi salam is an ahad. Isn't that the matn? Is that what you're talking about? You have to have mutawatir. Mutawatir is a lot of companions say it from different circuits, and it's impossible for them to lie. So if you tell me that I don't take the hadith al ahad, I'm telling you, how do you take the Quran then? Because it was Jibreel alayhi salam that told Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And how did you hear it from? Well, from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Well, that is ahad also. So you cannot tell me I don't take the hadith of ahad because of that aqidah issue, because that's exactly what it came. It came through Jibreel alayhi salam, and it came through Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Similarly in this, it came through Al-Khidr alayhi salam. So we take that in aqidah, we take that in the tawheed, inshallah. Number 49 on this one, says wujud bil-taslim kulli ma jaa bihi ash-shar' wa illam tadhhar ba'da hikmatihi al-uqul. Okay, so even though you're not able to comprehend, thank you, Habibi. This is my son-in-law, but Zaniar is taking me some water. So talk to each other. Bismillah. Alhamdulillah. I'm almost there, inshallah. Okay, I do have a commitment to come to you, inshallah. Oh, almost there. Here we go. So you take things that sometimes you cannot comprehend, you submit, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells you a few things. He tells you to do something and he gives you the reason why. And sometimes he tells you to do something and he doesn't tell you the reason why. You submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number 50. All right, here we go. 50. A drum roll, please. Halal drum roll. Yeah. There's no music. Okay. يَفْعَلْ اللَّهُ فِي مُلْكِهِ مَا يَشَاءُ وَيَحْكُمْ فِي غَلْقِ مَا يُرِيدُ. We have to submit that we belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَا يُسَلْ عَمَّا يَفْعَلْ وَهُمْ يُسَلُونَ. We don't ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala why he does things. We get asked why we do things. Okay, number 51. الراجح أن الخضر عليه السلام نبي. So again, the tarjih here, the scholars say, he may be a prophet, Muslim, because نُبِّئَ بِالْخَبَر. Because he was given the news. So that's a stronger opinion among the scholars. It's بقوله تعالى فَوَجَدْنَا عَبْدًا مِنْ عَبَادِنَا آيْتَيْنَاهُ رَحْمَةً مِنْ عِنْدِنَا. We sought a righteous slave from us. We give him a mercy from عندنا, from us. So that's why it's called لَدُنِّي عِلْمًا مِنْ لَدُنَّ عِلْمًا إِنْشَاءَ طيب. Okay, there's so much more to share with you, but I think that is plenty of alhamdulillah, doses to throw at you. There's so much more, but I think we're way over time. Okay, guys. So I hope you learned a lot from the story of Musa alayhi salam and al-Khidr alayhi salam. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among those who listen to speech and follow the best of it. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the etiquette in matters of acquiring knowledge and be respectful to our teachers. And also look forward to learn from other teachers, inshallah. As we are teachers, we learn from others, inshallah, and be humble and respect each other. Even if we differ upon something, we do so in a proper, polite manner. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to gather us in Jannah as He gathers in this life. Amin wa khidam. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Ameen. Wa salam alayhi wa sahbihi wa tabi'in. Zakum la'ana khayra. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.